was a time of civil war in the galaxy. The evil Darth Vader, commanding the Imperial forces, has attacked the rebel starship of the beautiful Princess Leia Organa. Leia, a rebel leader, has hidden the plans to the Empire's Death Star battle station aboard her ship. Somehow, Vader has learned of it. Before Vader could board Leia's ship, however, the princess fed the plans into the brain of a small droid or robot, R2-D2. Sending R2 away with special orders on where to deliver the plans, Leia turned suddenly and came face to face with several of Vader's stormtroopers. Showing her no mercy, they knocked her senseless with their ray guns. Meanwhile, R2 has joined his friend the droid C-3PO. R2 called for them to escape before they and the plans were captured by the Imperial forces, but 3PO was afraid they'd get into trouble. Just then, something exploded behind 3PO. And to get away from the flames, he jumped into one of the nearby life pods with R2. In a moment, they were hurtling through open space. Meanwhile, inside the starship, Leia was brought before Darth Vader.
"If you won't tell me where the plans are now, Princess Leia," he snarled, "you can tell me later when you've spent some time in prison."
As Leia was being led away, two stormtroopers reported to Vader that no plans had been found aboard the ship, but that a life pod had escaped during the confusion.
"The plans must be in that pod," snapped Vader. "Follow it and find them."
Meanwhile, R2 and 3PO had reached the planet Tatooine, but could not agree on which route to take across the desert. Finally, each droid set off by himself. R2-D2 walked alone for what seemed like hours. Suddenly, from out of the caves of the rocky desert, little Jawas scurried up to him and knocked him down with a powerful ray. 3PO was also set upon by the little desert people. When he woke up, he found himself inside their traveling junk pile, the Sandcrawler. Just as he had begun feeling really sorry for himself, however, he heard a familiar beep. Much later, the Sandcrawler stopped and a great door opened. R2 and 3PO were pushed outside, lined up with a number of other droids, and finally sold to a farmer and his young nephew. The young man, Luke, took the two droids into the garage. He helped 3PO into an oil bath, then began cleaning sand from R2's moving parts. Suddenly, a piece of metal broke loose, and a picture of a beautiful girl was projected from R2's face.
"Obi-Wan Kenobi, help me," she called.
Struck by her beauty, Luke wanted to hear more, but R2 would not allow it. "He says that the message is for this Obi-Wan Kenobi alone," explained 3PO. "I don't know an Obi-Wan Kenobi," said Luke. "He must mean old Ben Kenobi, a hermit who lives out in the desert." Just then, Luke's aunt called him to dinner, and the picture of the beautiful girl faded away. Later, when Luke asked his uncle Owen about Ben Kenobi, the man grew angry.
"You stay away from that old hermit," his uncle bellowed. "And as for someone named Obi-Wan, forget it. I think he died years ago when your father did."
Cutting his dinner short, Luke hurried back to the garage. He forgot about his uncle, however, when 3PO rushed up to tell him that R2 was gone. It was too late to go off looking for R2 that night, but early the next morning, Luke and 3PO started out. After several hours, they found him.
3PO immediately began shouting at him for running away. But suddenly R2 rocked back and forth and began beeping wildly. They were in danger. But before they could get away, a Tusken Raider stepped in front of Luke and knocked him down. Two others began pulling things out of Luke's land speeder. Then, strangely, all was quiet. Luke woke to see a kindly-looking old man bending over him. It was Ben Kenobi. "You're safe enough now," the hermit told him. "But you'd better come home with me until you feel better." In Ben's home, Luke told him R2's story. Together, they tried to get at the message hidden in the little droid. In a moment, the picture appeared.
"I am Princess Leia Organa," said the beautiful girl. "I speak to you for my father, chairman of the Alderaan system. Please help us now as you did so many years ago. Inside this droid are the plans to the Death Star battle station from which Darth Vader hopes to rule our galaxy. Take the tapes to my father on Alderaan. You are our only hope."
Later, Ben told Luke about the wars in which he had fought as a Jedi Knight. Then he took something from an old chest which he handed to Luke. "This is from your father, who was a Jedi Knight too," Ben explained. "He wanted you to have it when you were old enough." Luke could hardly believe his ears, but he managed to ask Ben what the strange object was. "It's your father's lightsaber," Ben answered. "The weapon of a Jedi Knight. He used it well until Darth Vader, one of his fellow knights, tricked and killed him. Vader used the Force for evil."
"The Force?" Luke asked, puzzled.
"The Force is the energy field that holds our galaxy together," explained the old man. "Jedi Knights could use that power to do good. You must learn it too, so you can come with me to Alderaan." Luke knew his uncle would not let him go to Alderaan, but he agreed to take Ben to Anchorhead to get a ship. Out in the desert, they came upon the ruins of a Jawa sandcrawler. Luke suddenly realized that someone had traced R2 to the people who had bought him. Luke jumped into his speeder and headed home, but he was too late. Brokenhearted at the death of his aunt and uncle, Luke returned to Ben. He had decided to go to Alderaan, as his father would have done. They had no trouble reaching the spaceport at Mos Eisley. Luke grew worried, however, when they were stopped and asked for their identification. But although they had none, the stormtroopers let them through. "What happened back there?" asked Luke when they were safe.
"I used the Force," said Ben.
"Now we can find that pilot who will take us to Alderaan." Han Solo, the pilot, and his Wookiee friend Chewbacca agreed to fly them to Alderaan for a very large fee. Their ship, the Millennium Falcon, did not look like much, but Han assured Luke that it could outrun even one of Darth Vader's starships. It did not take long for the Imperial forces to find the rebels. Suddenly, shots rang out.
"We're ready now," shouted Ben. "They're after us. Let's go."
As they ran toward the ship, Han Solo called out his orders to Chewbacca.
"Deflector shields, quick, Chewie. Get us out of here."
With a roar, the Millennium Falcon lifted off its pad in the docking bay and headed for deep space. Han's ship easily outflew the warships that tried to stop them. As the Falcon rushed on to Alderaan, however, Darth Vader and his friend Governor Tarkin were questioning Princess Leia. When she would not reveal the location of the rebel base and the Death Star plans, they announced that she would be put to death.
Before you go, said Tarkin, we'd like to show you what our battle station can do. Aim the guns at Alderaan. A great flash suddenly lit up the sky, and Alderaan was gone.
You see how strong we are? Boasted Tarkin. We will find your friends, and they will die in the same way.
Meanwhile, aboard the Falcon, Ben was teaching Luke about the Force. Suddenly, the ship began to shake.
Look, cried Han. Alderaan's been blown away. We're being hit by pieces of the planet.
Ben called for Han to turn the ship around. Try as he would, Han could not make his engines respond. The ship and its crew were being dragged toward the Death Star by its powerful magnetic beam. On the enemy station, stormtroopers boarded the Falcon, but could find nothing. When they were gone, some secret floor panels popped up and the travelers emerged. Ben announced that he would destroy the beam that had pulled the ship in. Later, two more stormtroopers arrived. Han and Luke took care of them quickly. Suddenly, R2 began beeping wildly.
He says Princess Leia is here, cried 3PO. Will you rescue her?
But Han was not interested in rescuing anyone until Luke told him how rich Leia was. With thoughts of reward money in his head, Han agreed to help. They formed a plan. Han would put a pair of handcuffs on Chewbacca, making it seem that he was a prisoner. Then, dressed as stormtroopers, they would try to find the princess's cell. The halls were guarded by cameras and gates with electronic locks. Reaching the cell area, Han and Luke knew they would have to bluff their way in. While Luke talked to the guard, Han slipped the handcuffs off Chewie's wrists. Then, pretending that his prisoner was escaping, he began shooting at the cameras, the gates, and the guards. In the commotion, Luke ran off to find Leia's cell. Catching sight of him as he burst through her door, the princess had some trouble understanding why a stormtrooper was trying to rescue her. At the mention of Obi-Wan Kenobi, however, she understood, and they rushed into the hall.
Don't be afraid, Luke called to her. Those two are on our side, but it looks as if our way out has been cut off.
Quickly, Leia grabbed Luke's gun and blasted open a small grate in the wall. The opening was dark and smelled bad, but jumping in was better than being shot. They found themselves in a garbage dump, filled with all kinds of trash. A watery slime reached to their knees. Suddenly, something stretched out toward Luke and pulled him under. But just then, the walls shook and moved closer together. The creature that had grabbed for Luke let him go and disappeared.
This room is a huge trash compactor, cried Han. We'll be crushed to death in here.
The four friends reached for beams that would hold the walls back, but nothing worked. Finally, Luke took a communicator from his belt and tried to reach 3PO in the control room.
Come in, 3PO, he cried. Shut down the garbage mashers. Can you hear me, 3PO?
Then, just as the walls were closing, Luke heard 3PO's voice and felt the walls stop. They were safe. Meanwhile, Ben had made his way to the beam control, which had drawn the Millennium Falcon into the Death Star, and managed to shut it off. Finishing his job, Ben moved quietly through the halls toward the starship. Suddenly, Darth Vader stepped out in front of him. Luke, Leia, Han, and Chewbacca had found the two droids by this time and were running for the ship from the opposite direction. But they stopped when they saw Ben facing Darth Vader.
"Your powers are weak, old man," sneered Vader as he fought with his former teacher.
"Not so," answered Ben, smiling, "for if you cut me down, I shall only become stronger." Vader lifted his saber in the air and brought it down on the old man's head. His robe had been cut into two parts, but Ben himself had vanished. Meanwhile, Luke and the others had rushed for the Falcon. Quickly, the ship rose from its pad and headed into space. But Governor Tarkin was not worried. He had bugged their ship. With Leia as guide, the Falcon flew through enemy fire and headed for the Rebel base on the fourth moon of the planet Yavin. Members of the Rebel force rushed out to greet Princess Leia when she and the others landed. The princess lost no time in telling the Rebels about the plan stored in R2's computer brain. Soon, after the plans had been studied, the Rebel General Dodonna held a meeting. He told his pilots that there was only one way to destroy the Death Star, through an unguarded shaft leading to the station's reactor system. "You will have to fly down this narrow opening and level off," he told them. "The target is only 2 meters across and must be hit at a 90-degree angle for the shot to work. It won't be easy." Luke had joined the pilots who would attack the Death Star. Before he left, however, he tried to persuade Han to fly with them. But Han did not want to go. Moments later, the fighter force was in the air. Nearing the Death Star, the first attack group prepared to dive toward the target. Luke's group, the Red Squadron, stayed behind to fight the enemy ships that came out to stop them. After a long time, Luke saw great bursts of fire in the target shaft and knew the first attack had failed. Next, the Gold Group leader and two of his ships headed into the target shaft. But Luke saw with horror that Darth Vader was right behind them. There was only one chance left. Luke's two companions were hit at once. As if he were dreaming, Luke heard a voice.
"Go with your feelings. Use the Force."
Then, another surprising thing happened. The enemy ships had been hit. Luke looked around and saw the guns of the Millennium Falcon taking aim at Darth Vader. Luke smiled and moved on toward the target. Again, the voice came.
"Use the Force."
Luke fired, then sped up and away from the Death Star. Behind him, he could see Darth Vader's crippled ship spinning out of control and heading for deep space. As Han and Luke flew back toward the Rebel base, the Death Star exploded in a huge ball of fire. The next day, a great ceremony was held at the base to honor the heroes. Once again, part of the galaxy and its people were free.